Christine Lagarde, direktorica Mednarodnega denarnega sklada, na vprašanje, ali jo kaj teži trpljenje grških državljanov.
Ne. Pomislim na majhne otroke iz šole v majhni vasici v Nigru, ki so deležni 2 ur pouka na dan, ki si po 3 delijo en stol in ki si srčno želijo izobrazbe. Neprestano mislim na njih, ker menim, da potrebujejo še več pomoči kot ljudje v Atenah.
In kako naj se Grki poberejo iz krize?
Tako da plačajo davke.
Kaj pa volitve?
Nekdo je nekoč rekel, da če ljudstvo ni zadovoljno z vlado, je treba pač zamenjati ljudstvo.
16. letnik Delavsko-pankrske univerze. Letošnja tema – dvojna kriza evrointegracij.
En lep pozdrav vse skupaj, jaz vas v imenu Delavsko-pankrske univerze vse lepo pozdravljam in se vam zahvaljujem, da ste prišli v tok velikem številu na prvo predavanje 16. letnika z naslovom Dvojna kriza evrointegracij. Zdaj mogoče, če čisto za začetek predstavim na kratko, o čem bo tekla beseda v letniku. Letnik bo, tema letnika je dvojna kriza evrointegracij, pri čemer se ta dvojnost nanaša na krizo kapitalizma na eni strani in na neko politično krizo evropskih integracij, se pravi Evropske unije in pa evroobmočja na drugi strani, pri čemer se pač te dve krize preplajata, zato smo dali naslov dvojna kriza evrointegracij. Zdaj, zadeva bo razdeljena v bistvu v 5 tematskih sklopov, vsak bo imel približno po en mesec. Prvi sklop, s katerim začenjamo danes, je zgodovina. Namen tega sklopa je preučiti v bistvu zgodovino evropskih integracij, pri čemer bomo pač pokazali, da zgodbe, ki jih vse skozi poslušamo v Evropski uniji, kot v nekem pacifističnem projektu, ki ne bi po stoletjih vojen združil evropske države, pač ne držijo in bomo pogledali na to skozi prizmo historičnega materializma in na ta način poskušali zajeti naravo Evropske unije kot nekega razrednega projekta kapitala. Pol druga tematika, s katero bomo začeli nekje decembra, bodo protislovja Evropske unije. Tukaj bomo v bistvu se fokusirali predvsem na 2 protislovi, na eni strani na nasprotje med centrom in periferijo, na drugi strani pa na nasprotje med delom in kapitalom v Evropski uniji. Tretji sklop, ki je s tem zelo povezan, je ideologija, se pravi pač na podlagi že raziskanih tematik bomo skušali pač razbrati, z kim prihaja ideologija Evropske unije. Zadnja 2 sklopa, Slovenija in pa strategija, sta pa v bistvu posvečena bolj ali manj nekim strateškim razmislekom. Slovenija sklop bo fokusiran predvsem na to, kakšna je pozicija Slovenije v Evropski uniji in kakšen recimo manevrski prostor ima še slovenska vlada pač v tej evropski konstrukciji, pri čemer bo ta zadnji sklop strategija bo pa poskušal pač zajeti oziroma definirati neke možne leve alternative evropskim integracijam, se pravi neko tako bi rekel, socialdemokratsko, socialistično Evropsko unijo, s čimer bomo letnik tudi zaključili in upali seveda, da se začnejo počas stvari pomikati v to smer. Danes je z nami na prvem predavanju letnika profesor Joachim Becker iz Dunajske univerze, politični ekonomist, specialist za vzhodno Evropo. Predaval pa bo v bistvu njegovo predavanje spada v sklop zgodovina in predavanje ima naslov Evropska unija, preobrazbe in krize. In zdaj bi v bistvu prepustil gospodu kar besedo. Bil vas pa še pred tem prosil, da ne kadite v prostoru, ker smo dobili tako komando strani naših najmodajalcev, da se ne več kadi. Pijačo pa dobite za šankom, pa po predavanju lahko kupite zbornike pri Aniti, ki je tamle. Ok, to je to.
Hvala. Dobri večer. Unfortunately, I mean, that's the only thing I will say in Slovene tonight. I can understand it a bit, I can read it a bit, but I mean, cannot speak it, so unfortunately I will have to speak in English, and since it is today the first lecture of this cycle of debates, I will go back into history And crises have been the turning points of the European integration project. And this crisis and how crises, earlier crises and the present crisis have been dealt with, that will be the structuring element of my lecture. And I will finish, of course, with the present crisis, which I think is the most profound crisis the European Union has so far faced. Actually, I would say that the European integration project has been a belated reaction to the crisis of the 1930s. 1930s were 1929, and then the 1930s were a crisis which was as deep as the present crisis. And actually, one can see some reactions to the crisis then by the national states, today by the European Union and its member states, which are quite similar. In the 1930s, the European countries reacted to the crisis by austerity measures, especially social expenditure, particularly the unemployment benefits were cut. Domestic demand was cut. Then currencies were devalued in order to hinder imports from the neighboring countries. All countries wanted to export, but not to import. And so far, bigger thy neighbor policies were adopted. Countries like Britain or France were able to unload part of the consequences of the crisis on the colonies. What was not possible for Germany, for example, or for Japan. And there was no international mechanism to deal with the crisis in a concerted way. Britain was not able anymore to play the role of the hegemon, and the US were not yet willing to do so. And so far, there was something like an international vacuum. The German aggression, the German war, and the Japanese war as well, the fascist aggressions, were in a way a reaction to the crisis as well. It were attempts to create big economic spaces, creating new colonies, mainly in that case, it's a German case, in Eastern Europe, in Russia, but there were plans for Africa as well, in the case of Japan, in China. And insofar, the reaction to the crisis in a way led to war. After the war, it was clear that the pre-1929 constellation could not be re-established. Even the liberal conservative establishment was aware of that. And it had to deal with the strengthened Soviet Union, which at that time had internationally quite a good reputation as one of the winning powers of the war, one of the few countries which escaped the economic crisis of the 1930s, so at the price of a very severe repression internally. And all these factors favored a new kind of social compromise in order to integrate the working class and eventually to expand the welfare state. Second element was that new forms of international and, in the case of Europe, West European cooperation were instituted. And the US government pressurized the West European countries to cooperate regionally in order to form something like a West European bloc against the state socialist camp. Secondly, in order for that to be able to work, the tensions between the West European countries had to be diminished, that the US pressed for compromises between the different countries in Western Europe. Thirdly, the United States were in favor of creating a more unified West European economic space in order for US-American transnational companies to be able to operate West Europe-wide within a more unified space. Though in the early 1950s, Western Europe was not a preferred destination for US foreign direct investment. That time it was still going primarily to Latin America. But the impulse for increased West European cooperation and then integration was not only due to the US pressures. The mainly conservative Christian Democrat governments of the time perceived the necessity to cooperate more closely as well. And some key areas were identified which had proved to be highly controversial in the past, especially at that time the key sectors were coal and steel. And so far one of the founding blocks of the emerging European economic community was a union of coal and steel. And this heavily regulated the competition in the field, and demarcated in a way the spheres of influence of German and French capital. Another area was atomic industry. And gradually in the 1950s, this was fused in a broader project of the European Economic Community. It included only continental European states. Britain was not part of that. And that is West Germany, Benelux countries, France, and Italy. And sensitive areas were dealt with in a manner that was built on compromises. German export industries, especially capital goods industries, were already rather strong at the time. And so far, that was a German advantage of reducing trade barriers, creating a customs union. The French government was particularly keen, conservative French government was particularly keen on protecting its electoral base in the peasantry and in agriculture. So far, special programs for agriculture were created. And I mean, they persist until today. For Italy, much less was in the basket, at least economically. But Italy got the international rehabilitation with its fascist past. So far, there was some element of explicit compromise. Second element was that the European economic community permitted to maintain different types of welfare states. There was not a universal model, and it created mechanisms which were able to accommodate different types of social policies that was not to be interfered with. And from the very beginning, supranational institutions which were not accountable or responsible to the national governments were created in order to have a mechanism, so not a very democratic one, in order to deal with the differences, the possible differences among the countries. I mean, and that basically amounted to creating the European Commission. So it was a very particular construction. This common space, economic space that was gradually created, beginning with trade and only later moving to liberalization of capital movements, this was stabilized by a regime of fixed exchange rates. So far, the parity between Deutsche Mark, French Franc, Dutch Gulden, that was fixed, and that was part of an international dispensation. And at that time, destabilizing capital movements were not possible because there were controls on capital controls. So far, this fixed exchange rate regime could work. Though it did not work without problems because the economic development was not totally even among the member countries. And so far, at times, the necessity to devalue emerged, especially for Italy. Italy, from time to time, devalued its currency in order to compensate the relatively high rate of inflation of the Italian lira. And it was a time of general prosperity. Things went rather smoothly until the beginning of the 1970s. Beginning of the 1970s. And already in the 1960s, some things were changing within the different countries. 1968 was not only a year of student protests, but as well of a lot of strikes in many countries. And it saw the emergence of a much more militant labor movement in many countries, particularly in Italy. And in the case of France, for a short moment, even these two movements joined forces. That was quite exceptional. And with that, the distributional compromise of the 1950s was questioned by labor. Labor wanted to shift the compromise in favor of labor, producing a more equal distribution of income, what capital definitely did not like. In addition, the domestic market became a bit saturated, productivity increases were not so rapid anymore, there was workers' resistance against the forms of production, and internationally the constellation became more tense as well because countries like Germany, Japan had accelerated their growth and they started to be a more serious competitors to the US. And with that, the international monetary system became under pressure as well. And in the US and in Britain, in the incipient liberalization of the capital movements eroded this regulation of the monetary sphere. And it became clear that the fixed exchange rate regime as it did exist until the early 1970s could not continue. And in so far, the European Union faced something like monetary instability as well. And in 1973, the fixed exchange rate regime internationally was abandoned. And with that, the exchange rate volatility inside the European economic community increased as well. And this has profound impact on trade relations, etc., within this regional block. And beginning in the 1970s, one can see, and that's the first crisis I'm speaking about now, that the forms of accumulation, the forms of development, of capitalist development, are changing. First of all, capital was more aggressively looking for export outlooks, export markets, especially in traditionally strong exporting countries like Germany, but not only in these countries. Secondly, German capital started, or West European capital accelerated the relocation of production, internationalization of production. And this undermined the national type of Keynesian regulation and started to put the welfare state under pressure as well. Thirdly, capital moved more and more into the financial sphere and pressurized for the liberalization of capital movements, and especially the United Kingdom inside Europe was a pioneer of the liberalization of financial markets and of capital movements. And with that, the volatility of the monetary relations inside the European Union increased. And the first reaction to the crisis was not yet to abandon Keynesianism. But the Keynesian policies were not so strong anymore. And tendencies to abandon Keynesianism became visible. And secondly, it was a question how to deal with the uncertainty, the volatility of the exchange rates created inside the European economic community. And in the beginning of the 1970s, a first idea of a European Monetary Union, the so-called Werner Plan, and Werner was the Prime Minister of Luxembourg at that time, was ventilated. This plan would have entailed a certain centralization of economic policy making inside the European economic community, a harmonization and centralization of economic policies. Still, it's an anti-cyclical idea in mind. But this Werner Plan was very early on aborted. So, until the late 1970s, this volatility persisted. And what happened was that in the early 1970s, the European Economic Community was enlarged for the first time. Britain, with a very different accumulation model from the rest of the countries, very different social model from the rest of the West European countries joined the European Union, but as well Ireland and Denmark. So that was already the EEC at the time of 9. Then in the late 1970s, a European monetary system was created. And this already had a different conception. It was the first step towards neoliberalism in the European integration project. And significantly, it had to do with money. It created a system of relatively fixed exchange rates with the Deutschmark at the center of the pyramid, and the rest of the countries in a way being dependent on the German Mark. The German Mark, Deutsche Mark, was the anchor of the system. And this implied that the German interest policies would have an impact and did have an impact on the interest rate policies of all other countries. All of them had to have higher interest rate than Germany in order to attract capital. And that limited already the monetary space for maneuver very, very, very significantly. And it limited, as it proved to be in the early 1980s, the space for fiscal policies as well. And in the early 1980s, in France, the so far last attempt of national left-wing, national Keynesianist policies were attempted by the Mitterrand government, Projet Socialiste. And France, at that time, nationalized the banks. They adopted expansionary wage policies, expansionary fiscal policies. It was a very nice program for German capital. Not the bank nationalization, but the expansionary policies, because the Germans were able to export to France. In France, the trade balance deficit increased very significantly. And at a certain moment, it became clear either the French government abandons its national Keynesianist expansionary policies, or it exits the European monetary system and devalues. Inside the French government, there was an intense debate what to do. And they opted for staying inside the European monetary system and to abandon their reformist policies. So that was the end of progressive policies in France. And so far, this neoliberal device, it really worked. It worked. Yeah? It was a warning to the other countries as well. Yeah? And so far, a first neoliberal device with the monetary system as a base was created. So that was the first very important change in the early 1970s. The so-called southern enlargement with Greece, Spain, and Portugal already happened within this transition towards neoliberalism. At that time, the European Union or European Economic Community argued that the integration of Portugal, Spain, and Greece should enable these countries a democratic consolidation. As you might remember, in Portugal, after almost 50 years of fascist dictatorship, in case of Spain, 40 years of Frankist regime, in the case of Greece, military dictatorship ended in the mid-1970s. And the European Economic Community reacted to this enlargement by instituting stronger regional and cohesion policies than they did exist before. But these policies were only mainly directed at infrastructure construction. But the entering the customs union, abolishment of the customs and other and tariffs, etc., put the industry in Greece, Spain, and Portugal under tremendous pressure. And the first wave of deindustrialization could be observed in all three countries. And a very significant increase of unemployment occurred, especially in Spain. And these three countries lost policy space for national industrial policies. And they were not compensated by pro-industrial regional policies of the European Economic Community, because the Germans were not in German capital, German government were not interested in that. And so far, this enlargement or integration of the South European countries resulted in deindustrialization and aggravated certain structural problems. And accumulation moved to services, to tourism, and to real estate developer. And these two usually go together. And credit, providing credit already started, in, for example, in Spain in the 1980s. And the Spanish government adopted policies of an overvalued exchange rate, about which the banks were happy and the industry was not. And that aggravated this tendency towards financialized development and deindustrialization. And with this type of conceiving the integration process, a certain structural divergence was produced, or deepened. Already it existed before, but it was deepened. And some protectionary transitional measures for the banking sector, some sensitive sectors, did not resolve the problem, only softened the impact. So that was a first enlargement. Then these were the first reactions to the crisis. In the mid-1980s, the European Union enacted a second neoliberal project, the single market. That is making free movement of commodities, free movement of services, free movement of capital, and free movement of labor force key elements of its policies. Though without harmonizing, for example, labor legislation, certain social rights. So they created the European Economic Community, created a space of competition, generalized competition, without harmonizing the rules. And with that, not only capital competed, but capital could play one regulation against the other by the way of relocating production, what is not so easy, but in the case of taxes, of relocating certain financial activities, maybe only the accounting. And with that, the national regulatory systems were put under pressure. And at that time, the architect of these policies, the then president of the European Commission, Jacques Delors, French social democrat, still thought that later social harmonization would happen, but it did never. So that was the next step. So you had a change in the monetary sphere, reducing the policy space for monetary policies and for fiscal policies. And now you had this single market with putting social security systems and the revenue side of the budget under pressure as well. And these policies fitted quite well with the internationalization of production of the West European capital. It was perfectly in line with that. And it fitted into the liberalization of the financial market and financialization as well. The next important step happened after the German unification. And that was a radicalization of the European monetary system, the creation of the European Monetary Union and the creation of the Eurozone. And the countries like France hope that with a Europeanized monetary system, the hegemony of the Deutsche Bundesbank, the German central bank, would be ended. That the interest rate policies of Germany, which were extremely detrimental to the rest of the European countries immediately after the German unification, because in Germany there was a boom and the Deutsche Bundesbank increased the interest rates significantly, whereas in the rest of the EU the economic situation was not very prosperous and they hoped for lower interest rates but had to increase in order to maintain the exchange rate, deeply unhappy with that. And for the Germans, European Monetary Union was okay, provided that it would be along the German philosophy. And the German neoliberal philosophy, which always had been dominant, except for a very brief period in the late 1960s, a neoliberal one, an ordo-liberal one. And that implied so-called monetary stability, low inflation reigns supreme, first point. Second point, no influence of the parliament, of democratic forces on monetary policies. Yeah. Independent central bank. Yeah. And, which is quite in line with neoliberal thinking and German neoliberalism of Eucken, etc., creating rule-based policy making. That is, not the parliaments decide according to the economic situation, economic cycle, which economic policies to adopt, but to have fixed rules, which are really fixed and permanent, and thus disempower parliaments and governments as well. And the accession criteria for the Eurozone, fixed rules, a certain limit of the budget deficit, only 3%. Why 3%? Nobody could say. Huh? 60% public debt stock as a limit. At that time, in a couple of countries, it was around 60%, so 60% was adopted. Yeah, I mean, that is a reason. Huh? So it's not that the magic of numbers, but I mean, it's a mythology of numbers as well. Huh? And certain, the difference between the interest rates should not be too large. There was no explicit criterion on the question of the trade balance of the member countries of the Eurozone. That was not discussed. That was not discussed. So the productive divergence was not dealt with in any way. So that was a German idea. The French were not too happy with that, because that is not in line with the French economic philosophy and the situation in France. So the French government had its own demands, and that meant not only a core Eurozone, but a large one, including the South European countries, which are important for France and for French exports, of course. And the Germans were not happy with that. Their idea, the main idea of the German government, was a small Eurozone, something like a core Eurozone. No? And it was less Greece that was debated at the time, but Italy, whether Italy should be included or not. No? And there were apprehensions of including Italy in the Eurozone, the public debate. So what was the end of it? The end of it was the German conception of rule-based monetary, of rule-based policy making, independent central bank, but with a large eurozone, as the French desired. And that with a very heterogeneous eurozone, which later created its own problems. So, what and this created, the reasoning behind creating this Eurozone were several ones. One was something like the international dimension. It was the idea that the Euro, that the euro might emerge as a second international reserve currency, not at par with the US dollar, but strong, and stronger than the German mark. That was one reasoning. So far, the international dimension that has not been abandoned until today. The German, the financial business was happy with the Eurozone as well because it created a monetary, joint monetary space where financial institutions could operate. A larger, potentially larger financial market. So they were happy with that as well. German exporters were very happy with the monetary zone because with a fixed exchange rate, the others cannot devalue anymore. And the South European countries cannot protect their economies anymore by devaluating the currency. They were happy with that. The French were content as well because at least the South was in the Eurozone as well. So they had the advantage at least in regard to Spain, Portugal, Italy, and Greece. What was the rationality for the South European countries? For them, the rationality was lower interest rates. To get away from the German dictate of the relatively high interest rates. And indeed, interest rates in Spain, Greece, Portugal, Italy decreased very significantly. So that was actually, it was achieved. So what was then the dynamics inside this Eurozone? The dynamics was that the structural divergence increased. I mean, I'm not talking about the GDP. At times, there was a pseudo-convergence, for example, between Spain and Germany, but not between, for example, not between Portugal and Germany or the old EU. But the structural divergence increased because the German government, especially the red-green government, adopted, because the exchange rate could not be manipulated anymore, so that leaves you with one option to increase price competitiveness, and that is reducing wages. And that's exactly the German policies from the late 1980s onwards was wage deflation. And actually, in Germany, for about a decade, the real wages declined. But they did not decline primarily in the export sectors. They declined primarily in the service sector. Because the labor market was re-regulated, significant low-wage segment was created, which today accounts for about 25% of the German labor force. And social security, especially the unemployment benefits, were cut. In the case of the unemployment benefits, they were very severely cut, so-called Hartz IV reforms. And this had the desired effect of repressing wages. And some neo-corporatist countries like Austria could follow this more or less the same road, though not as drastically as in Germany. The Germans had a lower rate of inflation than the rest of the Eurozone. And being the biggest and most industrialized economy, I mean, that had a profound effect on the rest of the Eurozone. Germany had something like a balanced current account in the year 2000. In the year 2007, the current account surplus was already around 6% of the GDP. And if the Germans exports, the Dutch exports, or Austrian export, I mean, somewhere there must be imports. The imports, the inter alia in Southern Europe. So, in Southern Europe, second wave of deindustrialization. And the trade balance, current account deficit grew very rapidly in Greece and Spain, and in Portugal it was already very high before, it increased even more. And in Greece, before the crisis, the current account deficit reached about 15% of the GDP. Spain, Portugal, about 10%. Italy is a different story, it's much less. And how can these countries finance that? By incurring foreign credit. So, German, French, partially British banks provided credit. Southern European countries imported German or French goods on credit. So, a huge mountain of external debt was accumulated over time. The case of Portugal, 2010, external debt, private and public external debt was about 250% of the GDP, almost 250% of the GDP, what is really enormous. The case of Greece and Spain, it was between 160-180% of the GDP, what is really quite high as well. So that was a very unbalanced development. And financialization permitted by providing credit to the South European countries to finance these huge current account deficits. And growth in these countries was on credit as well. Wages were supplemented by credits, and so far increasing consumption, and in the case of Spain, especially real estate and construction activities were financed on credit. And the Spanish Greek Portugal banks refinanced themselves in Germany, France, etc., in order to expand credit, domestic credit. So far, the debt of the private households exploded, particularly in Spain, and it had mainly to do with the real estate. And in the end, about 1 million flats were empty in Spain. It was more or less over. So far, a very divergent development, and between core and periphery, a structural gap widened, and the credit relationship only made something like a cover on that, but below that cover, the tensions were growing and growing and growing. So that is one periphery. That then, with the end of state socialism, a second capitalist periphery emerged. That in Europe, that is Eastern Europe. And with the end of state socialism, the West European integration project lost what it was aimed against at the beginning, the other side, the state socialist side. And the welfare state lost part of its raison d'etre. Because the welfare state was partially about integrating the working class in order to be attractive against state socialism. So the attractiveness decreased of state socialism increased over time. But with the 1990, that raison d'etre was over as well. And the East European countries were integrated into the European Union on purely neoliberal terms. Question of cohesion, regional development played less of a role and were funded less than in Southern Europe. Transitional arrangement, which would have permitted a certain transitional space for adapting the economic structures, played a much, much, much more reduced role in Eastern Europe than in Southern Europe. So far, this type of integration was even more asymmetrical than with Southern Europe. At the beginning, inside the European Union, and especially among Germany and France, there were differences whether Eastern Europe should be integrated at all into the European Union. The French were much more hesitant. Their main interest was rather in Southern Europe than in Eastern Europe, whereas for Germany that was different. With the entry of countries like Austria, Sweden and Finland in the mid-1990s, which had a profound interest in expanding into Eastern Europe, the balance of forces changed more into the direction of integrating East European countries into the European Union, into a neoliberal European Union. And the main benchmark for, informal benchmark for measuring whether the East European countries were so-called mature or ripe for integration was in how far they opened for foreign capital and how much they privatized. The only country which did not do so was Slovenia. Slovenia was in a rather comfortable situation insofar as it had a relatively advanced industrial base, which was mainly preserved even during the transformation to capitalism. The transformation crisis in the early 1980s was not as deep in Slovenia as in, let's say, Latvia, Estonia, or Lithuania. And the Slovenian government favored its industrial sector by preventing revaluation of the Slovenian currency. And it even introduced a mild form of controls on capital flows in order to prevent a huge inflow of foreign capital, which would have pushed up the tolar. So far, the government consciously tried to get a certain space for maneuver, and it faced a stronger social pressure from the trade unions than it had been the case in any other country of the region. So far, Slovenia, the internal situation was different as well. And in the late 1990s, the final decision to go for so-called enlargement was taken, and at that moment, West European capital investment into Eastern Europe exploded. And West European capital took over the key sectors of the East European countries, that is banking, with the exception of Slovenia. But in some countries, the share of foreign banks in the banking sector is close to 100%. For example, in Slovakia or in Estonia, or the Czech Republic, it's over 90% as well today. So they got control of the financial system. And secondly, in most countries, industry was taken over as well. And in so far, the development, accumulation in Eastern Europe was a dependent one. And with beginning at the 1990s, one can see that the Eastern Europe actually becomes divided into two different groups. One group is very closely linked to the German export industry. That is the Visegrad countries, Czech Republic, Hungary, Poland and Slovakia, plus Slovenia, where export industrialization in most of the countries, exception of Slovenia and partially Poland, this export industry being controlled by West European, especially German companies. And the second pillar being consumption based on credit expansion. no? That form of financialization. And in the case of Slovenia, I mean, this push for financialization was very strong after 2004, after accession to the European Union, but coinciding with the Janša government. And the question is, with Slovenia having a partially state-owned banking sector, why did the then government of Janša permit the very strong expansion of credit and the blowing up of a credit of a real estate and credit bubble? It could have prevented it, because it was in control of the banks. Could have prevented it. I mean, overheating was quite, visible. The credits expanded much more rapidly than the deposits. Therefore, the Slovenian banks incurred a lot of foreign credit in order to refinance the expansion of the credits, and that went to especially to the real estate sector. So that was homegrown instability. And of course, external capital by providing the credit was part of that. But there were incipient real estate bubbles in the other Visegrad countries as well. And in Hungary, credits were not in forint, but mainly in Swiss franc and in euro. So that created an extra problem. In the Baltic countries, Southeastern Europe, Bulgaria, Romania, export industrialization was much weaker or even absent. Baltic countries absent. Bulgaria absent. These countries, the exchange rate was linked to the euro in various ways, usually linked. Only in Romania it was flexible, but with very high interest rates. And in real terms, the currencies revaluated, and that was created a real pool for imports. Imports grew much, much more rapidly than the exports. So the current account deficit deteriorated as well, but even more than in Southern Europe at times. In the case of Bulgaria, Latvia, the current account deficit was more than 20% of the GDP before the crisis. And that was clearly not sustainable. External debt exploded. And the motor of growth in these countries was consumption and real, very often real estate. Very strong price increases in real estate, especially Latvia, Estonia. And so it was a dependent way of financialization that could not continue eternally. And in all these countries, the credits were mostly not in the national currency, but in euros or in Swiss franc. And with that, the middle class debtors, which bought flats for euro, or in the case of Romania, even bought refrigerators with euro credits. I mean, that is not a joke. Refrigerators in Romania were bought with euro credits, not with lei credits. People incurred foreign exchange debt to buy a refrigerator. And the banks financed that. And with that, it was clear that the devaluation of the currency would bring the debtors into real problems, because with that, their euro or Swiss franc debts would explode. So far, they were tied, really tied to the monetary order. And the monetary order, in order to attract capital, neoliberal policies. So they were tied to neoliberalism. Again, the monetary order is the main mechanism of creating a social base for neoliberalism. So that it's not, it has a very strong social political input. So, diverge, then so far, divergence as well, and divergence deepened by the monetary order and a certain type of exchange of monetary reform. So, in 2007-2008, there was a very huge heterogeneity inside the European Union. The credit, the very strong provision of credit, concealed this deep rift inside the European Union. So far, the European Union was already very strongly regionally, spatially polarized. And secondly, second polarization was increasing social polarization. The neoliberal policies had the desired effect of redistribution of income in favor of capital and in disfavor of labor. The profit share increased, wage share reduced. And within the profit share, it was especially income from interests and renting buildings, flats, etc., that increased very significantly. And so far, in the distribution of income, financialization was very visible as well. But consumption did not collapse in many countries because workers were provided with consumption credits. And so far, the social divide was a bit concealed by the credits as well. So, these tensions exploded, not only in the US. I mean, the UK was at the very beginning of the crisis as well, one of the starters of the crisis as well. Actually, the Baltic countries, their problem started in 2007 as well, not in 2008. And now, I come to the final point, the present crisis. Next turning point. And one could see that different countries in the European Union were affected in different ways by the crisis. Those countries who exported very strongly, Germany and the countries linked to Germany, that was especially declining exports, which played a major role, played a role in Slovenia as well. And some countries which were very, banking sectors which were very closely linked to the Anglo-Saxon banking sector, especially the Benelux countries, Ireland, of course, but to a certain extent as well Germany and France, faced problems in the banking sector as well. And their first measures were at stabilizing the banking sector, case of Germany creating a bad bank for hypo real estate, for example, and stabilizing the banks. And I mean, most money was spent by Ireland and Britain for stabilizing the banks. Then came the Benelux countries, and then countries like Germany, Austria, and France. The export problems of Germany, of course, had repercussions for Poland, Czech Republic, Slovakia, Hungary, Slovenia as well. And their exports declined very significantly as well. Those countries which were not part of the Eurozone, Poland, Czech Republic, fared better than the two Eurozone countries, Slovakia and Slovenia, 2008-2009, because possibility to devalue attenuated the crisis. But the rest of Eastern Europe was mainly affected by the drying up of credit. Hungary, with its high domestic foreign exchange debt, depreciation of the currency, I mean, Hungarian debtors immediately got into trouble. Hungarian banks got into trouble as well. In case of Latvia, fixed exchange rate regime became questioned. Latvia applied as well, and in Romania it was like in Hungary. So for them, it was mainly the credit channel which affected them. And what was the reaction, their reaction to the crisis? there is countries like Germany. Germany did not adopt strong fiscal austerity. It was even rather slightly expansionary one, even Poland. Yeah? But in the case of Hungary, Latvia, Romania, it was not the case. They adopted very strong austerity policies. And that was the worth the orientation of the national governments, at least the then national governments, and of the International Monetary Fund, and especially of the European Commission. And what was the rationality behind austerity? First, the main point was stabilizing the exchange rate at any price. And the banks did not want, the West European banks, Swedish banks, Austrian banks did not want a depreciation of the currency, because it would have implied a depreciation, devaluation of the assets in the region. They did not want that. Secondly, the banks knew the devaluation of the currencies, their middle class debtors are in trouble, in deep trouble. Middle class debtors knew that as well, and so far they were for maintaining the exchange rate as well. They were not necessarily in favor of austerity, but they were in favor of maintaining the exchange rate. And in order to create so-called credibility and to keep capital at least partially inside the country, was argued, austerity is necessary. What was quite obvious, that it was not possible to finance the current account deficits anymore. So, second point, and it's not less important, to reduce the current account deficits. And the current account deficits were reduced by cutting wages, especially public sector wages, by cutting pensions, and by reducing the budget. For example, in Latvia, in some quarters of the year 2009, domestic private consumption declined by 30 to 40%. 30 to 40% within 1 year. Much more than in Greece. Yeah? And the effect was, in Latvia, the GDP declined by 18% in 2009 alone. Yeah? For that, Greece needed 4 years. I mean, in Latvia, it was done within 1 year. And for example, the former state secretary in the German Ministry of Finance, now high-ranking ECB official Asmussen, said Latvia should be the example for Greece. Yeah? The Latvian government says as well, we are the example for the non-disciplined South European countries. They should do it like us. What did the Latvian government? It did actually achieve that the current account deficit temporarily disappeared. The GDP declined by 18%. That was the price for that. The unemployment more than doubled within a year. And mass, the immigration from Latvia accelerated even in 2009 to Great Britain, which was really in a very desperate situation as well. But nevertheless, Latvians emigrated in larger numbers from Latvia to the UK. So you can imagine, schools were closed down in Latvia and the countryside, hospitals were closed down, social situation deteriorated very significantly. In Romania, not much better. So Hungary with its industrial base, it fared a bit better. The debt problems were, of course, they were not resolved. You know? They were not resolved and could not be resolved, though the currencies in Romania and Hungary were stabilized, and in Latvia, the fixed exchange rate could be maintained. So this exchange rate issue was not so dramatic. People got into trouble because they became unemployed, yeah, or their income was reduced. So, and of course, the relationship private debt to GDP, public debt to GDP, I mean, it deteriorated because incomes fell, GDP fell. Yeah. And so far, the debt issue was clearly not resolved. The problem of the current account was only temporarily attenuated, but not solved, because the industrial structures were not improved in any way. Only mass incomes were cut. When growth emerged, I mean the current account deficit immediately deteriorated, so not very dramatically so far. No? So the structural problems were not tackled with. And it must be underlined that the European Commission was even harsher in its course in Latvia than the IMF. And the Swedish government, with a huge commitment of the Swedish banks, was even more aggressive than the European Commission. To be quite clear about that. Then in 2010, the South European countries, which had not been so severely affected by the crisis in late 2008, early 2009, because exports were not so important for them, and the credit crunch was not yet so serious, they were affected. And the structural divergence, of course, was detected by so-called financial investors as well. So they could have detected it before, but now it became interesting to detect it. And the Greek government, I mean, it was basically the weakest of the three countries and the most attackable. And then it was obviously revealed what many obviously had known before, that some accounts were a bit made nicer. And so the first country to get under pressure, which was facing high increasing interest rates, and increasing interest rates good business for banks, was Greece, and it had problems to refinance itself. And the German government waited, and then there was a question whether a Eurozone country would be stabilized with IMF involvement or not, and the German government insisted on involving the IMF. I think in order to have an external side which would take some of the blame for the measures as well. That's my suspicion, I cannot prove it. And then, I mean, for Greece, Ireland, Portugal, same type of measures, same type of policies like in Latvia, Hungary and Romania were adopted, plus privatization, which was not part of the game in Latvia because there's nothing left to privatize and it's not part of the agenda. And the credits of the European Commission and the IMF have been heavily conditionalized. And it is again about drastically cutting public sector wages in the case of Ireland, of reducing the minimum wages, Greece as well, reducing the minimum wage very drastically, weakening the trade unions by changing the collective agreements legislation, making collective agreements less binding than they used to be before, so structurally weakening labor, being part of policies as well, reducing pensions, weakening the public social security system, and so far there is a neoliberal rollback, a conscious one, and with, as I would say, with the aim of at least temporarily keeping these countries inside the Eurozone, so I would doubt whether it will be really permanently, and reducing at the same time the necessity to permanently refinance the current account deficit. Therefore, reducing the domestic demand very drastically. But the current account in Greece has declined much less rapidly than in Eastern Europe. It is still today, after this long recession, above the critical level. For example, in 2010, the Greek exports covered only 28% of the imports. It's really very, very little. And the refinancing of the Greek debts permitted, and the Portuguese debts, and it will be the same with Spain, permits the private banks to disengage from Southern Europe. Private debt is substituted by public credits. So Deutsche Bank, Société Générale, they can withdraw from the region, which is not so interesting anymore for them, and too risky. And the EFSF, the European Stabilization Mechanism, steps in, with public guarantees. So it is a estatization of potential losses, put it very, very bluntly. And when that was done to a certain extent, then a certain rescheduling and reduction of the green debt was actually done, though without any measures which would tackle the issue of the weak industrial structures in Greece. Or same thing about Portugal. And with that, the tensions inside the Eurozone are increasing. And now there is a discussion, like in Yugoslavia in the 1980s, who pays for whom? And reading German or Austrian press and comparing it with the debates in then Yugoslavia of the 1980s, I mean, it's really the debate who pays for whom, and it is question how the costs of the crisis are distributed in a heterogeneous, very heterogeneous, socio-economically heterogeneous state. There is an incipient economic disintegration inside the European Union as well, whereas in the case of Yugoslavia, the republics tried to retain the foreign exchange. In the case of the European Union, the banks try to desist from the risky areas, and the European Central Bank has to step in. At the same time, there's a certain centralization of attempt to centralize policies as well. In case of Yugoslavia, even the Markovic government with neoliberal policies tried centralization, so there was a dialectic of disintegration, partially political disintegration on the one hand, and attempts of centralization as well. Same thing, European Union, the attempts to tackle with the crisis imply centralization of economic policy making as well, but mainly in the Eurozone. And so far, the institutional differences between the Eurozone countries and non-Eurozone countries are deepened. First point. Second point, it's a radicalization of neoliberal policies. What has been applied to the periphery is to be adopted, institutionalized, at least in the Eurozone as a whole, in the form of rule-based policy making. And rule-based policy making is radicalized. The so-called Stability and Growth Pact, which is linked to the Eurozone, which brings neither growth nor stability, is tightened. Different ways of supervisory mechanisms are strengthened, and certain parameters are defined, and how the definition exactly is discussed between the national specialized bureaucracy and the European Commission specialized bureaucracy behind closed doors. Because that is not an innocent issue as well, for example, how you define public debt, what falls within it outside, for example, things like that. And with the so-called fiscal compact, the so-called golden rule for fiscal policy making, which is not golden, is adopted as well. And in Germany was the first country in the European Union to adopt that, and it praised itself has this been a very exemplary measure. And what can be observed in Germany is that the part of Germany which will pay for this tightening of fiscal policies, of permanent austerity, will be the poorer regions of the country, the poorer Bundesländer, especially in eastern Germany. And it's quite clear if the richer part of West Germany is not willing to pay for East Germany, which was partially ruined by the German monetary union, I mean, I would expect not a more generous German policies inside the European Union, very unlikely. And these policies will massively restrain the policy spaces in all the countries which signed this type of conflict. The policy space for the parliaments is drastically reduced, and the power of the technocratic bureaucracy is strengthened. I would say it is a type of technocratic authoritarianism which is emerging. And this bureaucracy is particularly open and is strategically selective in favor of big, large capital groups. So far, the social rift, social political rift, will increase as well. And this will, I think it will increase the tensions inside the Eurozone. It will not attenuate them. And as you know, in Germany, there are circles which have been louder in the past. Now they're a bit less loud, which are in favor of squeezing Greece out of the Eurozone. In order, because they see that the austerity policies are clearly failing in Greece, they're clearly failing, they will not produce a recovery in Greece. So-called short-term austerity will lead to long-term stagnation in Greece in the best of the cases. And in so far, they're better outside the Eurozone, but they want a neoliberal type of enforced exit from the Eurozone. And with that, the non-Eurozone core Europe, which had been an idea of a German and partially French capital already in the past, conservative circles in the past, I mean, core Europe or core EU is emerging. It is clustered around the Eurozone. Might be that Poland or Czech Republic later will join it, possibly. And secondly, the divide inside the Eurozone is increasing. Divide Eurozone, non-Eurozone is increasing as well. I mean, these are clearly disintegrative tendencies. And at the same time, democracy is hollowed significantly and systematically hollowed out. That is the second main tendency. And this is element of the crisis. Yeah? The anti-crisis policies in many regards are like in the 1930s. Possibly two alternatives, that my final point, would exist. One alternative would be something like a radicalized Euro-Keynesianism. That is, democratization, attempt of democratizing the EU, of having more expansionary policies in the core countries in order to alleviate the situation in the periphery, plus pro-industrial policies in the periphery with an ecological element. So-called Euro Memo Group, and I think one of the representatives will be here this month as well, John Graal, advocates such a solution. I think the problem with this solution is that the resistance against the neoliberal policies are very uneven in the European Union, because the dynamics of the crisis are very uneven in the European Union as well. the progressive forces, trade unions are not well organized at the EU level. So that's a second weakness. Thirdly, the institutional order of the European Union is a very serious obstacle for progressive policies. The acquis communautaire, the EU legislation, is anti-Keynesian, it is anti-social democratic in many parts, and it is very difficult to change it because to achieve the necessary majority is extremely difficult. So that's very, very difficult to change. These are strong factors which make it very unlikely politically that such a thing will happen. So there's a third option, which is not enough. We have no nice options are left. Third option is, I would say, part of the periphery consciously exit the Eurozone, trying to gain policy spaces for different policies. The national constellation of forces is not very favorable for that either. No? Though I would say it's more likely to happen than the Euro-Keynesianism. No? And in Greece, I would say that's the country probably which is closest to that, but on the other hand, with a very narrow economic base in Greece, the space for policy, for maneuver for alternative policies is very, 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 very limited. And actually, it would imply the core countries as first steps, first of all, pushing for different type of economic policies, more at least more expansionary ones. And it would imply to block the radicalization of the neoliberal deepening of the integration. Because with that, policy spaces will disappear. So far, I would say it is necessary at the moment to maintain and in several policy spaces, fields to increase the national autonomy vis-a-vis the EU institutions. And on the other hand, I would have no problems, even I would be in favor of transfers to the periphery, but linked with industrial, social, and ecological policies. So with a very, very different logic. And credits is not the same as transfers. That really mean transferring money. And I think that a left alternative EU at the moment, I think it is not feasible. And so far, I'm rather in favor of creating and enlarging national policy spaces, but with having solidarity inside Europe, not only inside the European Union, in mind. I mean, Europe is more than the EU. Voilà.
Thank you, Joachim, for a very interesting and enlightening lecture. I think that we still have about 15 minutes left for a short debate. So, if anyone would like to ask.
I have two questions, actually. The first one, you mentioned the policy of attempting to make the euro the world reserve, or the second world reserve currency, which is clearly causing trouble for almost everyone. And I'm wondering who exactly benefits from this and in what way. And the second question, it seems that all the options that you mentioned are future left development are at least very difficult. From one side, there's exit, but there's also the debt denominated in euro, which will cause huge trouble for debtors and so on. The EU is also entrenched, the neoliberal project. So it is the most feasible option is that things will go on as they are going on now. So how will that play out? What will be the consequences?
I think if things continue like that, things will not stay as they are. That's an important point. They will not stay as they are, and I think that they will lead to partial disintegration of the European Union. And I think of the Eurozone as well. I mean, there's already discussion about Britain leaving the European Union, and it's not really not impossible. And without dealing with this huge heterogeneity, I think the European Union will finish like the Habsburg Empire. Yeah, like the Habsburg Empire, it's a very, very, it's a very similar construction, yeah? Currency union, a hybrid type of state, yeah? With national governments having some competences, the central government having some competences, having a monetary union, having a customs union, being very heterogeneous. Yeah? So it seem a bit silly, but it's not looking at the things. It's not so silly. Yeah? And I think like Yugoslavia as well, and the way things are debated, and I mean the aggressiveness that emerged, for example, in the German or Austrian press in 2010 against the Greeks. Yeah, I mean, that was amazing, which for the short time the discourse, I mean, became very, very racist. Yeah. And I would not say that, I mean, the big corporations are not necessarily in favor of the disintegration of the European Union, or I would rather think the partial one, not a complete one, but the result of the policies actually can be a disintegration. And the second consequence of the continuation of the present policies would be quite clearly a strengthening of authoritarian elements of policy making and of weakening the welfare state. So far it would be a different type of Europe. Right? It would be a different type of authoritarianism from the 1930s. It would not be a fascist one. It would be an authoritarian neoliberal one. With atomizing trade unions, etc., rather than totally controlling them. And I think one has to acknowledge a difficult situation in order to make realistic strategies. So it's not a good idea to pretend that situation is better than it really seems to be. And I'm a pessimistic person, but I think one has to consider the real existing policy options. And the question of the reserve currency, I mean, for the banks, especially for the large banks like Deutsche Bank, it empowers them because they become more important players. The main currency they are dealing with is more important. It can be used in more transactions. Yeah. That's good for them. For export imports to other regions, it can be an advantage as well, because you can demand payment in your own currency. Yeah. Not for all commodities, but for many. So the exchange rate risk is shifted to those outside. Yeah. So that is for those with intense external economic relations, for these companies, that is an advantage. Usually that is a larger companies, of course.
Okay, any other questions?
Yes, in your opinion, where do you think Slovenia is right now in the grand scheme of things? on the periphery, in the center.
I mean, maybe it is in the semi-periphery, and in the way, I mean, Slovenia is to some extent closer to the center. So far, institutionally, it is part of the Eurozone. So that is, it has its own problematic. Second point is that is really different from the rest of Eastern Europe. In Slovenia, there is still relevant domestic capital. Whereas in the Czech Republic, Slovakia, I mean, the companies, the investment decisions of the companies are made in Wolfsburg, not in Bratislava. And this makes a certain difference. At the moment, for example, in Slovakia, the largest steel company, the largest private employer in the country, is will be sold by US Steel. It's unclear who will buy it, whether it will be Krupp, ThyssenKrupp, or the Ukrainian company. And of course, it will have certain implications. Whether partially state-owned banking sector in Slovenia, credit policies could potentially be influenced by the state. And then it's a question in which way they are influenced. Yeah? And of course, it would be useful to do it in a very different way from the last years. I mean, there's no doubt about that. But of course, in the international industrial division of labor, I mean, a significant part of the Slovenian manufacturing companies exports components. I mean, that Slovenia is similar to Austria. So far, I would say it is in an intermediary situation, and with being a small country in the political decision making, it has not much weight, but the same applies for example for Austria or Belgium as well. So that is not exceptional. And I mean, decision making power is highly concentrated. That's in the end, it's with the German government at the moment.
Okay, any other questions?
And what might be significant, adding on the Slovenian question, my impression is that the Janša government is invoking the possibility of applying for support, so-called support from the ESM, in order to increase its political leverage. It faces domestic opposition, and we think things might become like in Greece, or with having the European Commission and the IMF behind its own demands, it would be easier for the government to push through its own agenda. And insofar, I would say it is a conscious political strategy. The Portuguese right-wing forces actually were quite happy with a lot of demands of the European Commission, because that had been what they had demanded for a long time.
Okay. Any other questions?
No comments as well.
Just short, maybe, because we speak all the time about the European Union. So we had this rise and almost the fall of this empire. We could see the disintegration of welfare states and trade unions and so on. But maybe just a word on how is it related to Chinese, to China, and are we facing in near future more of some kind of Chinese model of authoritarian government and some kind of capitalistic state, let's say? Because disintegration of, if once it starts disintegrating European Union, it means it will fall apart also for Germany. It cannot stand alone. No?
I think it probably would not fall totally apart. And I would say for Germany, Russia is the option. Yeah. I mean, that is a certain complementarity. German industrial exports for Russian gas, I mean, that creates a lot of less conflicts. Yeah? And that's, I'm not making a joke. I mean, about that I'm serious. A strategic partnership with Russia, I would say for Germany it's an option. That doesn't mean clearly not integration, but so-called strategic partnership, something like that, yes. And I mean, Russia has some authoritarian tendencies as well. I mean, the question to China, the Germans, I mean, German economy has expanded its exports to China, to Brazil, some other countries in that category, and these exports have compensated for the losses in the south of Europe. But I think that this will not continue. First of all, the growth in China is slowly slowing down, and the Chinese model is facing its own contradictions as well. That is, too high investment, I mean a rate of investment of about 40-50%, extremely high, plus exports, very limited domestic market. Now the question in China is inter alia, whether it will be feasible to reduce external orientation, to increase domestic consumption, change distribution of income, increase wages. And that is a very contested issue in China itself. Whether China will become less outward looking than it is. I would say that the Chinese type of capitalist etatism is different from the type of authoritarian tendencies in which have become visible in the European Union. And so far, I would not expect a transfer of that type of model. On the other hand, there are tendencies that in China, the welfare state is expanded. So very slowly, but the tendency is there. In Brazil, the welfare state definitely is expanded. And so far, in the semi-periphery, very different tendencies from the European one can be seen. And the Brazilian way of the crisis, which is a mild reformist thing, but nevertheless it is built on wage increases, and conscious wage increases, especially minimum wage increases, expansion of the welfare state, industrial policies, so and strengthening the domestic market, not necessarily primarily based on exports. So that's very different from the European way, but that shows that the European way is not without alternatives. I mean, the Brazilian model, it does not deal with the power of the big corporations in Brazil. The ecological side of the Brazilian government is very weak, so it has its limitations as well. But what becomes visible, alternatives do exist, at least potentially do exist.
I think that we unfortunately ran out of time, so I would like to thank Dr. Baker once again. And invite you to our next lecture, same place, same time. The next week's lecture will be Sasha Furlan. He's there, our workers and punk celebrity, so you're all invited. And you can buy, as I said before, our books and publications there at Anita. So thank you very much for coming, and see you next week.